So hi everyone. So I'm Ashwini, and welcome to the second episode of Hashtag Being Supercharged from Ampliz. So see, unlike the other meetups, what we wanted to do with this meetup was very, very simple. We wanted to have fun, we wanted to make a lot of interactions, because ultimately if you have fun, you're going to enjoy it, you're going to learn more. So that's the whole concept, and that's what we're intending to do. So let me tell you a little bit of the Hashtag Being Supercharged as well. So we started this community on one focus. At Ampliz, let me put it out this way as well. Every Friday we have a session called the Gyan session, which basically anyone from the team talks about what they have learned in that week. So the product team, the data team, everybody gets together, and the growth team, of course, we all have a discussion about what's really happening, what do they have learned. It's just a knowledge sharing session that every Friday it's compulsory. People take in turns and do that. So for Ampliz, learning has been, the constant learning has been one of the key factors, and something that we also value, you know, from the core. So that's the whole idea of why we actually wanted to tell the world about what Hashtag Being Supercharged is all about, and make people aware. See, learning is important to growth. If you want to learn, if you want to achieve growth, you have to have constant learning. So that's the whole idea behind Hashtag Being Supercharged, and that's the reason why we named this show as well, you know, the same thing. So that's a little bit about Hashtag Being Supercharged. You know, there's a team outside who can help you with your Hashtag Being Supercharged moments as well. So let's get into this session. So last week we had another event as well, and every week subsequently we will be having different meetups. So we will be having meetups every Friday here. The idea is to learn, to grow, and to network, of course. So on that note, today I'm really pleased that we have Sam Mathews from Fable, who's a growth manager at Fable. So he's been incredible, because Anishwar was talking to me the other day. He said, you know, he was ready when we had to ask him, and was just, you know, with the right energy and the right spirit. So thank you so much, Sam, for that. So please give us a little bit intro about, you know, what you do at Fable and what kind of revolution I'm trying to make there.
I'll just come here.
Sure.
Yeah. So hey guys, first of all, can we get people all the way at the back, a little front, because I like it when people are like, you don't need to sit at the back. Let's make this as informal as possible. You don't need to be scared, right? It's okay. We're all marketers. You need to be loud. Oh, some people are trying to. Yeah, so yeah, my name is Sam. I lead the digital team at a company called Fable. Fable is a health tech startup. We are headquartered out of HSR, just down the road. So we are like your neighbor, like your noisy neighbors, I guess. So what Fable does is it provides a solution for people suffering from long-term illness. So people, especially with diabetes, pre-diabetes, hypertension, which need continuous care. So we are giving them a digital solution by providing them with a mobile app where they can get their health trends and insights communicated to the doctor. And so the doctor can then have a look at these patients and then intervene for their care. We are not, so we are niche in a way that we are only in the space of lifestyle diseases, people who suffer from lifestyle diseases. So that's what Fable does. I'll just go ahead and start.
Sure.
Yeah, I'll just my PDF is.
Okay.
Yeah, cool. I think I'll have to scroll because I did a bad job in.
No, you can make a full screen.
Yeah, cool. So, yeah, so I just wanted to, before I start, could you just can I just do a quick round of intro?
Sure.
Could I just tell me about yourself, what you're doing, what industry you're in, B2B, B2C, and something interesting about yourself. Cool. Okay, all the way back, because you were sitting at the back, so we'll start. It's a punishment. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I work as a data engineer at Ampliz.
Okay.
And my primary role involves like developing deep learning systems for various B2B like intelligence data intelligence platforms.
Got
it.
Wait, something interesting about yourself.
I love reading books and coding.
Cool.
Hi
everybody,
I'm
Rikita.
I'm a new
joiner
here. It's my
fifth
day on at work. And I'm a junior software engineer, data machine learner.
Something interesting about
yourself?
Skip, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
My name is Soel. I work at IBM.
as I look after marketing at the place.
Okay.
Interesting.
Oh, that's something interesting.
My name is Ankit and I work at UIU in Daniel in Beverly. And I like swimming.
Sorry?
I am Ankit Pare. I work at UIU in Daniel in Beverly.
Right.
And something interesting is like, I like swimming.
Oh, cool.
Hi everyone, good evening. So myself Shashwar. So I work in Valley as well. So I look after sales, the sales part. So I clean new acquisition. It's like B2B. And as far as hobbies are concerned, I like reading and I like to meet new people. Yeah, that's all.
I'm Karnakar, I'm a content marketer here at Ampliz. And I like reading,
running, artistic stuff. I'm Deepa, I'm a senior SEO analyst in marketing team, and my hobbies are like I'm a part time YouTuber.
Oh, thanks.
I'm George, I work for a company called Breakthrough. So we are an outbound training company, and for Breakthrough, I'm a data analyst. I love reading, and I love training people.
Myself, hi, I'm working in the internet marketing team. I do SEO and I do marketing.
I'm Prakash. I work for Ampliz growth team. And I do a lot of traveling and I love seafood.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm Naresh. I'm a freelancer, digital marketer. Okay. I have a huge interest in content marketing. So something interesting about me, I love to travel. So I dedicate at least a month, a long month.
I want
that joke.
Yeah, that's good.
Hi, my name is.
Oh, wait, I'm Sabyasachi. I'm from Metric Fox, the digital marketing arm. So, interesting about me is I'm surviving here for the last 5 years.
Yeah.
That's an achievement.
I like that.
My name is Tripti, and I work here in Ampliz as a content creator.
Hi, my name is Jyoti. I'm working as a SEO executive. Like it's like from past 1 year, I'm working. I'm working my 1 year computer. And interesting is like I do a lot of things like guitar, kickboxing.
Yeah. You can't miss it, okay?
And yeah.
My name is Apache. I'm working as a SEO executive.
Very interesting. Come on.
Myself, Varun Heremat. I work as a junior growth hacker for Ampliz.
Okay.
And the interesting part about me is I rap. And, afterwards.
Yeah.
And the interesting part about me is that I play football. I'm a professional football player as well. Supporter,
yeah.
Arsenal.
Okay, happy
rivals.
Yeah.
So, and I like to travel and I like all the outdoor games, like I used to like, I play and explore all the things. So that's it, that's it.
Yeah, hi, I'm Adarsh,
I'm
a video editor and designer in Ampliz.
Just
about
me,
I
work for
Ampliz.
Okay, obvious.
Hi guys, my name is Varun. I'm a community growth marketer for Ampliz. And something interesting about me is, love to connect with people, share my experience and learn, love and share all the things which we learn. And apart from that, I love football. Yes, of course, I'm a Chelsea fan.
Oh, okay.
Yes. And at the same time, travel is something I want to do in the coming years. So yeah, that's been part of my biggest dream I want to do this year.
Good sir. I think we missed you. Yeah.
Hi, Jatunya. I'm from Brazil. I'm from the sales team. Been in sales for the last 8 years. Love food, hiring.
So let's get started. One of the things I'm really passionate about as a person is growth. I just love growth. Anything related to growth, I love talking to different entrepreneurs and finding out their growth challenges. That's something that I love. And over the past 2 years, I've been in the mobile app space. I'm not like an expert. Okay. Dropping a truth bomb. I just have 3.5 years of experience, but I have literally learned leaps and bounds these 3.5 years, right? And it's that experience that I want to talk on mobile app marketing. So a little bit about me. I'm an engineer. How many engineers there? Jeez, what are we doing in marketing? So all of us know, right? I'm an engineer and yeah, I turned into a passionate marketer. How I knew that marketing was my calling was, you know, I'm the kind of guy in engineering, if there's any event, I would want to make it big. So I would be like, oh bro, there's this event, there's that event. And that's when I knew, and I knew that was marketing. Like, you know, and then I was like, intrinsically, I knew that that's what I was passionate about. Like, I want to make anything that I'm passionate about look good. And so that is marketing in a nutshell, right? You make something look good to someone. Isn't that what marketing is in a nutshell? And that's what I was doing in engineering. All my events, regardless if it's good or bad. If it's bad, sorry for you, but you need to make it look good, right? So that's how I got into marketing. My first job, I worked in a robotics company as a business development guy, and I hated it. Like, 1 year, I was like, what am I doing here, you know? So that's when I was like, okay, this is really not, while it is part of marketing, that's really not what I wanted to do. And so that's when I started exploring digital marketing, did a course on it, I read countless articles. I keep reading LinkedIn, I follow people, and that's how I got interested in digital marketing and started to build my skill set. While I was doing that, I built my own website from scratch. And through that, when I launched it, I got like 2 to 3 brands suddenly. Like, they just reached out, hey, I like your website. And I just put, you know, I'm passionate about website development, content, and all of that. These 2-3 brands came back to me and they're like, okay, we need your help. And that's how my digital marketing journey started. And after that, I joined a company called, I didn't write the company name, called App Browser. So App Browser is a mobile app. I was doing mostly content, social media, and growth related activities. And now, so I did that for 1.5 years, and now I took a huge jump to where I am today. I joined Fable last year, October. So it's been very recent, like 3 months as the first marketer in their team. They are just entering the market and they needed someone to lead the digital team, and that's what I do right now. I think I kind of talked about the next slide. So I've done a little bit of freelance gigs. I help grow multiple brands in different industries. I am a brand consultant for a real estate and automation company. I also I've built several websites, did content, SEO for at least 6 websites. These are big brands, and you know, they just got in touch with me to get there. And in terms of mobile growth, I was part of the team that grew App Browser from 500k users to 3 million users. I think that's quite an achievement. And I was in charge. So in App Browser, one of the main departments I was taking care of was revenue generation. So do you see ads on mobile apps? That's how mobile apps make money. And I was just in charge of that. So any annoying ad you would see, that's because of me. I would be like, okay, we need an ad here. But we were making money because of that. So I was in charge of that. And now I'm currently building the growth strategy. So cool, enough about me. Let's just get started with what the topic is. Just let me know how much time I have. Just let me know. Just keep me updated. Cool. So we're going to start about the mobile app market. Before I get there, how many B2B people here? Yeah, it's majority. How many B2C? Okay, so my talk is mostly in line with B2C, but the fundamentals remain the same. So that's something to keep in mind. Even if you're in B2B, the core fundamentals of what I'm going to share is similar. Right, so I'm going to talk about the mobile app market. All of you know that we're living in a mobile world. You know, we've got like close to 5 billion mobile phones in the world in 2020. This is the state of mobile in 2019. So we've got like 194 billion app downloads. And people are spending, because of that, around 120 billion. And then on the Play Store itself, there is 2.1 million apps. So if you are in the mobile app business, you're already in an overcrowded market. Okay, one more question. All of you have mobile phones? Raise your hand. Good. All of you have mobile phones. When you have a mobile phone, are you in a day, how many of you browse on Chrome rather, or how many of you use like an app? How many of you use an app most of the day? It could be Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, whatever, app, right? Most of us use apps. Very rarely when we want to say check out something is when we open Chrome. Am I right?
Yes.
Same use case?
Yes.
So people are spending time more on the app when it comes to the mobile. That's why mobile app marketing is like super important for every business, right? And the challenge for every marketer in the mobile app business is that there are 2.1 million apps on the Play Store. Can you believe that? Like, it's like crowd all over the place. How are you gonna stand out? How are you?
Sorry, what is that 120 billion consumer spend?
So basically, from the total mobile app downloads, people are like spending money through their apps, and it's contributing to that market. In the mobile app business, people are generating, I mean, businesses are generating 120 billion just on the mobile app, on mobile apps, right? So that just gives us a context. So I'm gonna get started with in 2020. I'm not gonna talk about what the past, but what's happening today and how to get your mind aligned to that, okay? Okay, now this is my like holy grail. How many of you have seen this or know this? Good. That means you're good with growth. Your fundamentals are strong. So this is the growth funnel. And typically for every mobile app, you have, everyone say this with me,
acquisition, activation,
retention, revenue, referral. So you need to understand, acquisition is where are your users coming from. Activation is from those users who are finding you, are they having a great first experience? Are they getting activated? So a typical use case of an activation for a mobile app is once the download happens, their mobile registration. That could be activation. That means, yes, I've got that user activated in my app. Or it could be something else like Gmail login, right? So that's activation. Retention. So I'm not sure what the number is, but 60% of users approximately who download an app never come back after the first time. Okay, that's like a startling like fact. And so as a marketer, as a growth marketer, you need to understand how to retain your users. Great, they installed your app, they activated, how do they come back? Right? Then comes revenue. So yeah, they can use your app, but it's like not great until you get money from them, right? So you need to focus on revenue. And then referral. Are they sharing your app or telling people about your app? That's referral. If you have got referral right, you have made it in the mobile app business. Everyone dreams of referral. And B2B people, same thing. Same funnel, doesn't change. Which is why the core of mobile app and B2B is the same. So this is gonna be, there's going to be a lot of intersection, okay? So that's the growth funnel. Now, part of the growth funnel, it is so important to identify your leaky bucket. Anyone knows what on earth this means? Take a dig, anyone. What's a leaky bucket?
Where we are lagging.
Where you're losing. Exactly. So, where in this funnel are you losing users?
Retention.
Yeah, like I mean, yeah, it varies from different businesses. For some businesses, first of all, they're not even getting acquisition, so there is no leaky bucket. They need to focus first of all on getting new users. For some people, yeah, people are downloading, they saw an ad, but they are not registering or they're not activating. For some people, great first experience, then they are lost, like oh my gosh, like where are they gone? And obviously they're not making any purchase. So as a growth marketer, it is so important. Like I cannot tell you. See, acquisition for a mobile app is like very easy. And let me tell you this, if you are in the B2C space, install is nothing. Install, I'll just repeat that again, install is nothing, it's a vanity metric. No one cares about installs, they care about activation. So in your growth funnel, more than acquisition, care about activation. So I would actually put activation higher than acquisition in terms of my funnel, because I want people like registering with me. I don't want like, see, you can just run, I'll tell you, just go to Google Ads, run a mobile app campaign, you'll get installs. As simple as that. Put $500, you'll get. But what's the use of those installs? You will see the conversion rate, like I've seen in some cases, 2% of people who have seen the ad and activated. That's how bad it is. Because there are so many apps, like how, so the problem with the mobile app business is, it is so much more easier for people to be on the web than downloading an app. Why? Because you're literally asking a user to download a property into their mobile phone. Like, so to go on the web, it's easy. Everyone has internet, they can just scroll, browse, whatever. So you have a website, SEO is easy. But for the mobile app, you're literally asking them to download like 20-30 MB and put it on your phone. That is more of a proposition for the mobile app market. So you need to understand, where is your leaky bucket? Okay, I'm going to take an example. Okay, so this is a sample mobile app. We've got the action, installs, mobile registrations, profile. So you see, this is the step, okay? They've got installs, mobile registrations, profile completed. They landed on the home page, there's engagement and purchase. I want you to tell me by looking at this sheet, where's my leaky bucket? Where do I need to work on? So let me tell you, this part, conversion rate, is in relation to the install number. Step-by-step analysis is, you know, what's happening in between steps. So look at this sheet, tell me where is my leaky bucket. Sorry? Home page and?
Engagement.
Okay, why do you say that? Okay, so here's what I would say, my leaky bucket is in mobile registration, engagement and purchase. Because I got 550 users, but only 400 is registering. That's the first issue I have to solve. Only 72%, that means I'm leaking 28%. And then rest of it is fine. My homepage and profile people are coming, 90%, perfect, very good actually. But then there is a drop to engagement. Only from the homepage, only 62% of my users are engaging. And then there's a huge drop. Revenue, I mean, this is a usual funnel of a mobile app. So we need to understand. So my leaky bucket, in my view, is mobile registration, engagement, and purchase. That's my leaky bucket. So to get your growth mindset, you need to, as a growth marketer or a growth hacker, there's a lot of hackers nowadays in this world, growth hacker, is a marketer is responsible for these two, a growth hacker is responsible for all stages. So a growth hacker now needs to understand, oh, how can I get more engagement? How can I get more purchase? He'll do experiments. And that is how, as a marketing team, you would put your effort, put your resources, spend money on those kind of things. Each mobile app is different. So you need to identify, why is my mobile app getting this many leaked users? And do experiments, change a button, change a color, put this feature, I think then they'll be more engaged, you know, stuff like that. Put the revenue maybe first, give an option, do A/B test. And that's how your growth mindset starts in mobile app marketing. Wait, so far so good? Cool. Let's go to the first thing, okay? First thing is acquisition. Now, I'm going to tell this, okay? Like, how many of you know paid marketing? No, wait. Your strength is paid marketing. Your strength is paid marketing. Raise your hand. Okay, cool. Oh, no one else? Oh, wow. That's pretty interesting. Okay. So, I tell every marketer this. If your strength is only paid marketing, you're not a marketer. Because paid marketing is so easy. When a startup or a business has money, paid marketing, amazing. Deep pockets, go to your CEO, sir, give me 5,000, I'll run an ad. Not every startup has that luxury. So you need to, first of all, understand like where you stand, first of all, as an organization, and as a marketer, how do I get acquisition? Apart from paid marketing. Because paid marketing is an easy bit. You have deep pockets, you can spend. But how would you get users otherwise? So I've just put like, you know, a very common thing. So one myth I wanna break is mobile app businesses should not shy away from the web. They absolutely, if they are doing that, it's like the biggest, like, I don't know why they're doing that. Lot of mobile app companies will not have a great website or a web strategy. They can use that to convert users to their mobile app. So build a great website and have a good SEO strategy. Have landing pages, have a good keyword strategy, have a great blog, be informative. Put stuff on the website. Because web traffic is so much more easier than app traffic. Right? True? Everyone's on the web. Internet is free. I mean, it is not free, but ideally, like, people love to browse. So focus on the web. If you are not focusing on the web, it is so hard. Like, and you're only, you're only putting money on paid ads. I'm sorry, like, you're not a marketer. You need to. I mean, it's so easy. Even a 10th standard student can run ads these days. So as a marketer, your true strength comes. Like, if say I was taking an interview, I wouldn't ask anything about paid ads. I'll be like, how will you get app downloads without paid ads? Right? So, cool. Second, ASO. ASO is simply SEO for the app. So ASO is the title, the description, the app screens. When you download an app, you look at the app screens. Very important. How would you design your app screens? Convert them. Then there are reviews. People read reviews. It's huge in ASO. If you have a good review rating, like say for example, you go to an app, okay? Everyone's talking about it, okay? You suddenly go to the app store, but find it 3.8. Something's wrong. You already have an inhibition. Already there is one inkling in your mind saying, I don't know. So rating, so important. Reviews, so important. That's ASO. Anything on that your property is ASO, okay? Social media. Having a good social presence is very important. Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, name it. Social media. That's how you can see. Social media is a long game. You need to build a community. You need to build your value proposition. People need to be commenting about you, sharing about you, making you go viral. Then only you get acquisition. And the last thing is obviously paid campaigns, other channels, and all of that. Paid campaigns you can run. So the market leaders right now for mobile app downloads is Google and Facebook. Obviously, they own a huge share of the market. So I'll just show that. So if you're going the paid route, this is how I would typically put my spends. I would put 60% on wall gardens. What are wall gardens? Google and Facebook. So Google, and how many of you know this term called wall gardens? Raise your hand. No one. Okay. So a wall garden is an ecosystem that is independent of itself. That's Facebook and Google. So Google, how is it a walled garden? Because they don't care about anyone else, they just care about themselves. Google and Facebook. So Facebook only cares about its businesses. It won't share its, how do I explain this? A walled garden is basically an independent ecosystem, right? It's not like a DSP. A DSP is different. They act on both sides, supply and demand. But Google is independent. Facebook is independent. So you would club them as walled garden. So I would, because Google and Facebook has a 90% penetration in the market, I would spend a chunk of my money on Google and Facebook advertising my app, because a lot of people are on Google, a lot of people are on Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, whatever, right? DSPs are people who, so there are a lot of apps outside of Google, right? Say, let's take a Paytm, for example. Paytm has a huge database, right? I mean, they have got a lot of users. Suddenly they decide, I want to do marketing for other apps. So then Paytm becomes a DSP. they are getting demand and giving supply. So that's proven. And there are a lot of apps like that in the market outside of Google and Facebook that are giving people traffic. So that's programmatic DSPs. I would spend ideally 10% of my spend. Then ad networks. Outside of Google, Facebook, there are a lot of ad networks. TikTok. There's AppNext. So AppNext is a company that allows you to get featured on every Xiaomi and Samsung device. So you need to identify where are these channels. What am I trying to do here for you guys is identify your marketing channels. If you just have one channel, you're screwed. Have like a variety of channels, right? And then obviously there's a whole world of affiliates. So affiliates are people who, like, say an Amazon is an affiliate who allows your ads to be on their website, and you can convert users as a mobile download. So you can target, say for example, that would be an affiliate, I think. Like, say for example, InShots. I want to be part, like, very relevant audience, tier one. A lot of people are downloading InShots, they have that scroll thing. You want to put your ad. So that becomes an affiliate for you. Right? Cool? Can I go forward? Okay, so DSP is like a bridge, okay? They act as a bridge between users and other apps. So say for example, I'm a DSP. I partner with a Paytm, I partner with a InMobi, I partner with a... So there are multiple apps and I act as a DSP for users to come download from these apps. So I contact the DSP saying, hey, I want to be on these apps, could you help me? And DSPs do that for me. They're like a whole world, okay, of DSPs, like, it's crazy. So they operate from last what I heard, they have traffic, daily traffic of 5 billion impressions. That many mobile apps they're connected to. And people try because they are getting money, DSPs are getting money, advertisers are paying. So it's a whole business.
Is this a full name DSP or?
Demand side platform.
Demand side.
Yeah. Okay, case study. Now coming to real stuff, okay? So this is an actual case study I have experienced. How many of you know the referral campaign? Google Pay? Yeah, everyone refer, right? So you get incentive for every user. So that's a referral campaign. So we did a referral campaign for my previous company. And so we were averaging around 300 installs, 350 installs daily, okay? Then we were like, my CTO decided, let's do a referral campaign, PhonePe. Like this was last year, March, okay? My CTO decided, GPA is doing, PhonePe is doing, there's already so much advertising for it, people are doing it. Why don't we also do a referral campaign? So what was our referral campaign? We designed a campaign where people could share the app and they would get points in their wallet. And when they reached a threshold, they would get money credited. So we are not exactly like Google Pay, like we would not give money in real time, but people would have to share the app so many times to get referral points in our wallet. And then they could, we did that we designed it in such a way that, you know, we would get a return ROI, because if we are giving like everything money, then it's like we are screwed, we are spending more, right? So we did a referral campaign, and I kid you not, by Jan 17, you can see that, like, I came back to my play console and it was like it literally jumped to 16,000 in a day, or 16,000 in a day. That is the power of doing experiments like these. Growth experiments. So a referral campaign is a growth experiment that you could try, or you need to understand what kind of experiments you would try. And then the next day, so what people were doing is, people were telling, like, you know Telegram, how many of you know Telegram? Yeah, so Telegram doesn't have this cap of 256 users per group, right? Telegram has lot of, you, I think 5,000 users are there in a group and all of that. So people were telling, the people were putting our app in these Telegram channels saying, hey, there's a referral campaign going on. You need to jump into the boat. So they are sharing it. And in a day, we are like trending. Like, we've trended across every category you could think of. Shopping, you name it, entertainment, we were trending across all the categories in the Play Store. Why? Just because we launched one feature, we also didn't know what it would bring. But it just blew. Acquisition like just went up, right? Here's another surprising thing. There were micro influencers on, we don't even know them. They were putting videos on their YouTube page saying, hey, download app browser, you'll get this. Like, we were like, what's going on? You know, that is the power. And they would put the link, download the app. So that's how we're getting more downloads. Like, it just kept going on and on and on. So one growth experiment by you could make all the difference for your mobile app. Right? So you need to like start thinking about growth experiments in that. Okay. Another growth experiment. Okay. So what did these guys do is their Play Store page was so horrible. They just put some screenshots. Their description was very vague. They just put whatever. And they were just like surviving in the market. And then, so there's this app called Kiwi.com, and what they did was they did keyword research. So there are tools like Moz and SEMrush for ASO. I'll tell you about that. Those tools would tell you for a keyword how much traffic you would get for your app. Just like how on the web people search, those tools tell how many downloads you can get for that keyword. So they did that. They did the research. They took high traffic keywords with low competition. That's how you would do your keyword analysis anyway. As a business, high traffic, low competition. That's your holy grail of keywords. Work on that. They worked on that. They optimized their keywords, put it in the title, description, and the long description. I would say 2 to 2.5% is the keywords you would put in your long description. 2 to 2.5 for your high ranking keywords. And they changed all their app screens. They made it very bold. They made it very flashy. They played around with colors. They put a video, all of that. And then what they did was, this is the biggest thing. They did app localization. Anyone knows what that means? They localized their app for languages, Hindi. Or I would say, in their case, it was their country. And look at what happened, okay? So they were just like strolling along. And the moment they did that, their organic installs, not paid, organic installed grew to 72%. And they did another change and then it grew. So just simple things like this, mobile apps are not doing. Just simple things like these would help you grow, right? So this is a case study on ASO. Am I going too quickly? Is this okay? Cool. Okay. So this was acquisition, and now coming to app engagement, right? So acquisition is only one part of the game for mobile apps. You get downloads, but how would you engage them? And these are the metrics to keep in mind. Like, so you would smoothen out their onboarding process for an app, right? After install, if it's taking them so much hard work to get them registered, there's a problem. You need to really smoothen out that process, right? So onboarding, adding push notification. How many of you get push notification on your mobile? Dunzo, everyone does it. Why are they doing that? For you to come back to their app. That's app engagement. Push, personalized. So how many of you have apps where they say, hey Sam, we missed you, come back. Yeah, Mintra does that a lot. Personalization. They're calling you by your first name, like that's like something. Yeah, that's personalization. You motivate your users. How many of you get 50% off today as a notification? So you come back, yeah, right? Then feedback. You get feedback. You do consistent feedback, right? And so some of the key metrics to keep in mind when it comes to engagement. How many, first of all, number of users you have. Second is, how many of them are active? What is their, so This is very similar to the web. These are the kind of metrics you would see in the web as well. So how many sessions are they doing? So a session in a mobile app is 30 minutes. So how many sessions are they performing? Or how many sessions do they have in your app? Session length, out of that 30 minutes, how much are they spending on your app? Is it 1 minute, 30 seconds? It's very similar to the web. Yeah, retention rate, very important. I'll show you a slide next, retention rate. And then, do they rate your app? So it's good to have 1,000 users. Out of those 1,000, only 50 rated your app. So you need to push them to, oh, are you having a great experience? So that when people come and see, you know, people write amazing comments, wow, great app, amazing, and you know, you motivate your other users who are coming. Okay, cool. Now, okay, I'm gonna show you two products. Which do you think is better in terms of retention? So let me explain what this is. 1 to 360, this is one calendar year, and this is your retention. Which curve is better? Product A or product B?
B.
Yeah. Because for product A, on day one, they got around 75% of users. On day two or day 10, they dropped. So you need to keep this, you need to keep this curve as high as possible. How do you increase your retention rate from D1? So a common metric to have as retention as I keep is D1, D7, D30, D90. I don't go more than that, otherwise it's like it gets too tedious for me to calculate. And your tools do that.
Can you say once more?
D1, D7, so basically it's day 1, week, month, and 3 months, quarter. So in D1, what's your retention rate for the month of Jan? In D, what's your retention rate D7 for the month of Jan? And your tools tell you that. So if, say for example, D1 is always higher, obviously. It's like, cannot be lower than D7. So if your D1 is 30%, what does that mean? You're getting new users on the first day, but on the next day, only 30%. Which means your leaky bucket is right there. You need to get that to 40% on a month-on-month basis. Now, there are several, see, every industry changes, okay? So you need to understand what industry you're in. A gaming platform will have a very low D1 because gamers, they play for one day, they get excited about an app and then they leave, which is very common in a gaming app ecosystem. So you need to keep in mind what industry you're in. For a healthcare company like ours, our retention should be very high because we are getting very loyal users who want to use the app. So if our retention number is low, then we're like, oh, there's something wrong. So you need to understand what's your industry benchmark and keep this curve as high as possible. So when you now put your D1 curve, then your D7, D30, D90, it needs to be as high as possible. There shouldn't be much of a drop. Now, a drop is very common. You see that across industries because people download the app, they don't come the next day. So it's very common, but try to keep it as high as possible. Okay, and I'll show you some case studies. Yeah. So Easy Diner, okay? They are a restaurant booking app. What did they do to get their D1? They were struggling with D1 and D7. So that's the common problem in the mobile app ecosystem. D1 and D7, like meaning the next day and the week retention is like very low in a mobile app ecosystem, okay? So what did they do? They did location-based targeting. They would send, so it's a restaurant booking app, right? So they would identify where their users are and they would send localized push notifications. They would be like, hey, you're near this restaurant. You could book a restaurant. Like, and there are tools that would do that. Engagement tools. They did user targeting. So they understood, okay, younger audience like these kind of restaurants, older audience like these kind of restaurants, seasonal couples like these kind of restaurants. So they would push and they would know, they would segment their users and they would send push notifications to them. So you're becoming very personal with them and very relevant. And multi-channel, they were not only on the app, web as well, SMS, because they have their mobile info, right? So what happened because of that? They saw a 10% increase in sessions, Now that is amazing to me. Their open rate, like literally, so people were very dormant in the app. They would open the app 72% more higher because of this. So if you're not sending any push notification, that's a problem. Because no one will come back to your app. You need to remind users to come back to your app, right? And their uninstall rate significantly reduced because people were feeling like, this is a good app for me, it's useful for me, right? So that was a really good case study that these guys did. Okay, I'm almost ending. Know your tools, right? In app analytics, there's Google Analytics, Firebase for general. So Google Analytics and Firebase will give you like general app analytics numbers, like they'll give you your retention, they'll give you your DAU, MAU. How many of you know this now? Okay, a lot of B2B. So DAU is daily active users, monthly active users, their weekly active users, DAU, MAU, WAU, they'll give you number of installs, your play console. Sorry, I forgot to put that. Play console also, it'll give you number of installs. Okay, so now there's a difference between a general app analytics tool and an attribution tool. How many of you know what an attribution tool is? Okay, so an attribution tool is basically these are tools that will so these tools, GA and Firebase, won't really give you what happened after a user clicked an ad. They'll only tell you once the user's in your app. But if you want to know what user clicked which ad and then comes into the user flow of your app, you use an attribution tool. So there are a lot of attribution tools, apps, flyers, similar. So why are these important? Because I want to know where my Facebook ads are taking my users to and what's the drop off.
So basically it helps understanding like where the leaky bucket is.
Yes. No. Even this will give you on an overall basis. But this will give you from a campaign level basis.
Based on ads.
Yeah, based on ads, based on organic, based on
mediums.
Yeah. So see, that's the problem with the mobile app industry. There are so many tools, not one tool will solve your problem. That is actually one problem. See, in the web, because it's so many years of the web, people have built, GA has built a very strong analytics platform where you can track mostly everything. You put a UTM parameter, you get everything. But not in the case of app. So you need your attribution tool. Then you need ASO tools. I told you about how you get keyword traffic. So these are the tools for that. I personally use AppTweak. It's a really nice tool. It will give you the approximate number of installs in a keyword. And you would do that. And then there are engagement tools, very important, to send push notifications. I want to send notifications to users who are less than 20 years old. I can do that through this tool. I want to send notification to people who haven't done this event in my app. Say for example, onboarding process, they forgot their mobile registration, they dropped off. I want to send a notification to that user. And they are programmed in that way. So it's very important to set the base before you scale. Like a lot of, yeah.
That notification will go as a message?
Push, yeah. So there are different ways of sending. One is a push, if you have their OTP registered user, if your onboarding has OTP registration, then you can send an SMS. If you have email, you can send an email. So all these tools will give you that. And you can segment and personalize. A first name, if they put their first name, A last name, A your age is this, that number, and you can, it's time to party or whatever. So you get creative. How many of you use Gunzo here? They're very creative with their push notifications. Have you noticed?
I feel Google is much more creative.
HubSpot.
Okay, HubSpot is. No, Gunzo, how many of you are like, they give you like Hindi songs as push notifications? I mean, that's pretty cool. I don't know how many people open it, I don't, but people are opening it. Why are they doing it otherwise?
Have you tried Google Maps push notification? It shows that your reviews have been crossed 20,000.
It's very, actually,
if you are a local guy, it's very appealing or it's very interesting.
Yeah, and also when you go to a place, they tell you hate this place.
Yes.
So, very contextual. What is Google Maps doing? They're telling users to be more on their app. That's what every app business should do. So, you need to have engagement tools. Cool. I'm mostly done. You guys can take a break or you can feel free to ask any questions from this presentation. I hope it was helpful. I know most of you are in the B2B space, so but the fundamentals are the same, don't you agree?
Yes.
Yeah.
For us it's app engagement, for you is human being engagement. Take them for dinner. Sir, come by my interview, take them for dinner. Retention rate is there? Oh no, we'll give you an offer. Same thing. I don't know what else. Like, if your leaky bucket is you only have the sales guy's number but not the CEO, then that's a hey, give me that phone number, man. So that's a power problem, huh? Yeah. So the fundamentals are the same, you know. So I hope something you got out of this presentation. But yeah, any questions? Like, I'm sure people will have questions. So what we've been doing at Fable is slowly what happens is we send system generated alerts, okay? So when a user performs an action in the app, automatic push notification gets triggered. So say for example, a user So this is the app. A user orders medicine, okay? So there's, I click order, I won't click otherwise my sales team will call me because they want orders. So I'm not gonna click. But when I click this, an automatic push notification will be alerted. So that was very helpful for us to tell our users in real time that this is what you have done. See, although it's like a message in the app, but you also send push notifications as just a reminder to tell them that you have done something like that. And that really increased our retention. Something else that we're doing is we're running campaigns. So we send healthy tips because we're in the healthcare space. It's Valentine's Day, so we send something related to Valentine's Day today. So you need to be very, like just in the B2B space, right? Like say for example, Diwali season, right? And you want to host the event. So you call all your clientele and you tell them, hey, so that's an engagement. And that's what we also do. So that's one way to increase retention.
Can you give an example of how we have used other tools to improve
So attribute, okay, this is very important. Very nice question. So this part, attribution, a lot of people only stop at this because they're free. But attribution is not free. You pay for every non-organic install. Okay, that's how attribution tools work. See, if I want to measure my Facebook ads performance, you can get information from Facebook ads about CPI. You can get what is the cost per install and all of that. But I will not know from Facebook what that user did in my app. GA will give you overall. But attribution tool will tell me these users from this campaign, you got say 500 installs from a Facebook campaign. This attribution tool will now tell me from 500 how many registered, how many activated, how many engaged. I can define events in my mobile app and I can get that data. So on a campaign level perform. So say for example, I did an A-B test on a Facebook ad. I want to know which performed better. I'll get a very high level perspective from Facebook ads itself about CPI, but that doesn't tell me anything. Like, okay, I got good CPI on this, but I want to know what's the quality of users. I may be paying more for an ad, like me, one of the campaigns, the CPI is more, but I'm getting good, loyal users. That is what this will tell from a campaign level, basis. And also I can see my creative, which creative is. So they will tell me that. So Singular is very good for that. They'll give you analytics like 2D creative, 2D caption of your ad, in our
app. And defining user each step by step. Yes.
Okay, if you are a mobile app, the first thing you need to do is grow this. The first thing you need to understand this. You need to set up your funnel on Firebase. You need to tell your tech team, okay, this is where I want this event fire. Lot of mobile apps do this mistake. They launch their app before like doing any basic thing. So when I go to some mobile app, like some mobile app developers, that I say, you know, they have an amazing product, no doubt, good UI, great experience, but they don't even know what their funnel is. So they don't know what growth experiments to do also, right? So yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
Normally, an app user, they will not prefer to go to browser. Normally.
Yeah.
Okay. So initially, you said so normally people who are building app, they are not giving importance to the website landing page and all.
Yeah.
So how it will be beneficial to giving importance to the landing page? Because normally our target audience is app users.
Yes.
And they will not go to browser.
Yeah.
So how come?
Oh, okay. Yeah. I understand your question. So your question is, why are you putting your effort on the web?
Yeah.
If you only have an app, very simple, to get more new users. So you're making web as a channel to get downloads. So say for example, you searched a query on Google about a very personal topic, and a brand is talking about it. And you read the blog, it's very nice, and the blog has a CTA. Oh, by the way, we have a good offer for you, download an app. I would download.
No, yeah, I think people do, because like just yeah. Few days back, there is an app called WhatsApp Direct, right? But like without saving number, we can send.
Right.
So like that was not working for me. So I typed in like WhatsApp Direct, what other apps are there?
Yeah.
That I browse. And I got so many, and with that, I love.
You download an app.
Yeah.
So you would use your website.
It's basically for awareness. Mm-hmm.
Not only awareness, for acquisition. To get downloads as a channel. Never forget the web, guys, because web is like everyone's there. Like it's so easy. I mean, I'm not saying it's easy, but it's a good, you need to have that as part of your mobile app channel. Lot of mobile apps, if you see in the industry, they don't even have a basic website. Imagine they get 0.1 of the web. 0.1 or 0.001. That itself is huge. Is huge. So we saw that you know, different apps were using you know, the referral campaign. And what we also noticed is that a lot of users are doing it. So here's the thing. As a growth marketer, this is amazing. So you see what apps are spending money on and training users to do that. So now you jump into the bandwagon, because you don't need to do much marketing. Already marketing has been done. That's how you would build your web strategy actually. Okay, like you see a lot of big brands are bidding on keywords, and they're putting a lot of ads like me, Fitban, all of that. Put a landing page on that keyword. You're getting free traffic. Same thing, referral.
Where the first, like, when did you initiate?
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah, that was very interesting actually. So we didn't do any campaign. We didn't, we just sent a push notification to our existing user saying referral. Now, then the next 2 days, we are wondering where this traffic is coming from. Some guy somewhere has put our app in Telegram. From there, some 10 videos came on YouTube. So that's how it grew. Like, you never know where. And that's the thing about mobile apps, it's very difficult to really understand where your users are, but that's something like that happened. Some guy saw this offer, put it on Telegram, from there some 5,000 users, and everyone wants money, right? Everyone likes money. Okay. Yeah. So, and everyone wants money in their wallet. They put that app on this is this, and YouTube videos are now, we're seeing like 10 YouTube videos in a day. People are just putting download app, browser, you get this. Like, wow,
because
okay.
That is true. They are actually at YouTube.
Yeah.
Part time YouTubers.
Yeah. So they will do that, right? Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of micro influencers that are doing that.
Yeah. Do you have any kind of partnerships? How do you get partnerships?
partnerships, so we are trying to build a ecosystem for the healthcare space. So we are partnering with clinics. So our model is ideally B2B2C. So table with doctor to users. That's ideally our model. But I come into the place where I say B2C to B. Why don't you get users and then connect to doctors? That's where I come into play. So B2B2C, so our sales team partners with a lot of clinics. They go to clinics, tell them about Fable, you get this, you get these things, USPs, all of that. We are also partnering with hospitals soon. The moment hospital comes, oh, that's the game. Like, imagine a hospital, in a day there are 1,000 patients. So imagine you open a hospital, you're already getting like that many users.
Yeah,
I can't wait for that. So I'm waiting for my head of sales to give me some good news. Obviously, like in the B2B space, there's so many similarities, you know, in the B2B space, the more the potential of the client, the more harder it is to crack the thing. Because they already have deep pockets, they're already investing in something, why don't they look at you? So that's where we are also trying to...
Can we take the questions offline because we have to have a networking session?
Actually,
when you use that what do you use? There should be some points, then they will get money.
Yeah.
And that only increased your graph. You didn't thought that about like if we give like directly money,
then what? I'll tell you why we didn't give directly money, because then we would be broke. Like every second if people are getting a referral, like we are sending money, like. So we are like, okay, let's be careful about this.
No, means after that also you didn't think about
that. Yeah, because it was working for us, we didn't switch. So it was working for us, so I think it was worthwhile to do.
A question on Facebook Live as well. It's like when you are starting. It's like when you are starting, it's better we have to focus on website or like on app.
Oh, that's a really, really good question. Here's what I would say. For the website, it takes a longer time to get organic traffic. So start website, but work on the app initially. But start doing your SEO strategy initially. What's your website going to look like? Is it a blog? What are the landing pages going to be? What are the keywords? Do your keyword strategy and your optimization for the website, because you want to work on your web. Because that could be an amazing source for acquisition, and then focus on obviously the other app activities. So that's what I would say. Cool. Thanks, guys. Thank you so much. I hope this was informative. Wait, I just have a moment. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sam. I think you've taken a great time and effort to come here and talk. I think we had a very fun and quite an interactive session, just like I said before. So thank you so much. So here, you know, you guys are here. We just wanted to tell a little bit about what we do at Ampliz and, you know, why are we doing all these things. So just like I told you before, so learning is very crucial to Ampliz, and that's why we have this hashtag being supercharged community, which focuses on learning. So the product that we are building, you know, we are actually in the process of building a SaaS-based product. So it's just launched. It's a Chrome extension that we are building, basically assisting the sales and marketing folks to kind of get more leads. By leads, you know what I actually mean. So today, if you look, you have these contact information about if I have to prospect somebody, if I have to contact somebody, I probably might get their contact number, their email ID, probably their LinkedIn profile. But that information is just not enough. You need to be equipped with additional information. Say for example, if you're going to have a first sales conversation with a potential customer, just having this information doesn't make much sense. You need to have that rapport building conversation topics. So it kind of just not closes more deals, but kind of builds a relationship with the customer as well. Say for example, you're talking about the funding that they're having or the technical stacks they're using. And you know, it could be anything, the recent hiring, whatever they have done. Any additional information that will, you know, convert the prospect to becoming a customer, that information is crucial and something that is what we are kind of, building on. So let me just give you a glimpse of what the tool does, and probably if you have any questions, we can take it from there.
This is the tool that we're currently building. It's called the Ampliz SalesBuddy. The tool is available for download in the Chrome Web Store. So this is your onboarding page. You can log in with your credentials. So if you want to give it a try, you just can install the plugin. And once you're doing that, sign up with just your email ID. You will get your password on your inbox. So just make sure you check out your inbox for that. Okay, let me just tell you how this tool works. I'll keep the dashboard away for now. So, for example, if I consider MailChimp as my potential customer and I want to have some sort of a business conversation with them, just open MailChimp and launch this tool here. So, our tool is actually designed in three different steps. The first section, if you can see, it's basically a prospect with scope, which tells you, see, there are about thousands of leads you might have. You know, if you want to kind of make the judgment if this prospect is right for your business or not, in just a second you can make a decision with this code. So what does this code mean? But before that, I'll have to tell you about the parameters. So every sales guy has certain parameters upon which he will judge if this prospect is required or not. It could be in terms of revenue, employee size, the industry that you're working in, or the location, because these are the top four consideration every sales or marketing folks have. So we have made that as a filter, and what Ampliz SalesBuddy does is it evaluates MailChimp with the parameters that you set to give you the score. So a good score is above 70%, so you know, okay, this prospect is right for me, let me go ahead and make a conversation, right? So once you have that score, now what you need? You need the contact number and the email ID. So below that you have this information where you get the key decision player's contact information, right? So just that just is not enough. Now, when I say this is one of my potential customer, I need some more leads. Just click on the similar matches, you will find an exhaustive list of all the other companies that you might want to prospect. Again, this is crucially dependent on your parameters that you set. So it's very important on how you set the parameters. So here you just can visit any random website here and just launch the tool again, and you will find their contact information. Right? So this is one of the features. Now, so we are currently running on a credit system. So you will have few credits in your account. So every contact you view, one credit will be deducted from your account, and it's all favorited, and you can go to the favorites to download it on your system as well. That option is also available from here. Now, here you get the company and the contact information. So by company information, you actually get the revenue, the headquarters, the industry that they belong to, and of course the revenue size. Now, one thing that differentiates among us among the crowd would definitely be the feature called contextual intelligence. So, like I told you, we just not in the business of data selling. Data selling is pretty old. We don't want to do the same thing again. What we want to do is we want to give you the relevant information that will make a difference for you, you know, when you're having that business conversation. Any information you think, say for example, you have 100,000 leads, okay? If you want to make that decision, today if I have to contact the top 10, who would that be? Right, so that deciding parameter, let us know, and we will get the data delivered to you. As long as it's in the public forum, let me make that huge highlight. So we kind of go through the nooks and corners of the internet to find the public data available, so that it can help you make those decisions. So this is a whole idea of what the tool does. In case you have any questions, I'm ready to take them.
How does Ampliz make, like, does it see what business I am in and then give this score?
No.
Or any website, or how does it give that percentage?
So it depends on the parameters you choose here.
Okay.
You're going to change the parameter?
Oh,
say for example.
Also now.
Yeah.
Okay.
So just change it, the score will change. Say for example, I don't want India, I don't want UK. And it's just US. Okay. Just click on save. It's different. It changes. It doesn't match in terms of industry, whereas it matches in terms of employee, revenue, and location. So what parameters it matches, it gives you a green tick. If it doesn't match, it gives you a red cross. And in case you don't set any parameters, say for example, I'm removing everything from industry and just click on save, it's going to show a blank on the industry. So here you can make that decision. So that's pretty much the tool that we are building on, and this is, you know, we're doing a lot of in terms of the data, we're kind of improving on a lot of aspects here. So yeah, if you are interested, you can, you know, sign up. Deb is here to help you out in case you need with anything with regards to the sign up process. In case you need any additional information, you can always visit our website. There's a product demo session, and we'll be able to help you out in, you know, in particular to your business as to how Ampliz SalesBuddy can be of help. Okay. So, thank you so much, guys. I think, you know, on a Valentine's Day, I'm you know, it's really great pleasure to see you all coming here and, you know, really, you know, being a part of this knowledge sharing session. I think we've definitely learned a lot from the great person here. So thank you. Please come again, because we're going to organize events every Friday. You know, that's the whole point, because we want to learn as much as possible. So that's the whole idea. So thank you for coming, and I hope you have a great time. There's some more refreshments available, so please enjoy. Thank you.
Can we just have a small photo?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And by the way, posters, we have like around 3 minutes left.